So if you paid any attention to the last video I uploaded, it has some pretty nefarious underpinnings there, and the implications are pretty obvious. If we're just looking at this for what it is, we're talking about an interconnected network that could potentially deliver private data about an individual, you know, every other door home in America being lined up with, let's say, for example, cameras, that being sent off to private businesses, corporations, and other third-party entities that you aren't aware of and don't even know their business practices. What we're looking at is when these things become ubiquitous, standardized, the ubiquity of these things tends to transition into forced implementation. What I mean by that is once we saw like cell phones becoming quite ubiquitous, actually let's start with like the banking card. Once the banking card became common and you know everybody was swiping their card, then they implemented the chip. And because the banking cards were so ubiquitous and they put it in the chips, everybody started to have a chip and they started to desensitize people to the RFID, which is one of the precursors to the you know the implant, right? That was one way they did this. Now what they're doing is with cell phones, because ultimately, if we're talking about some perceived future where there's going to be an implant, a type of, you know, mark of the beast type scenario, we're going to look at something that has to be all-encompassing, and you got to have a pretty darn good reason to put this into your skin, okay? Some people to make purchases, some people to track them if they're lost, some people have in their medical information, you know, if they're found passed out or something and have all their allergies. Those are three things that could be included in a microchip right there. Just imagine all the functionalities or most of the functionalities of a cell phone being included into a microchip as well. This thing would sell, okay? And with that ubiquity, you know, just like we see the standardization of these cell phones, companies, businesses, corporations, all these different entities will start to implement the programs and scenarios, you know, programs and sort of functionalities around based on around these smart devices. That's what we're seeing, right? Companies that develop these apps and you know, augmented reality, everything that's focused around this technology. So we get this technology, then we expand on it. So ultimately, when we come out with new innovations for it, we will incorporate that into us, and we will see the biotechnological become incorporated into us. We'll have the technology be implanted into us. It'll be wearable. We're already talking about wearable sensors, and that's one of the things here is like with insurance companies. What we're talking about is the ubiquity here. If life insurance companies, some life insurance companies are saying, "Hey, you wear this fitness tracker," like if Fitbits become ubiquitous, and they're saying, "Hey, we'll just buy this $100 Fitbit. We need to see when you're sleeping. We need to see you're making sure you're making enough, you know, exercise, so we can insure you." That's what life insurance companies are requiring. And just like the article said, what if home insurance companies start saying, "Hey, we'll give you a discount off your home insurance if you put this camera here?" And once we start to see these, the standardization of this, then we can see, "Hey, well, law enforcement says, why don't you register your home here for this perk? You know, name your perk. Why don't you register your home security footage, from the cloud onto our law enforcement website for, you know, pick your perk?" And now we're talking about an interconnected database where we're literally watching everybody, and then you include the integration of facial recognition software, and even if it is not the government or the state or you know, pick your poison, putting, you know, some facial recognition detection software on a camera on the street corner, we're essentially talking about homes and businesses and having these cameras. They don't have to do that. That's what that article meant by we're essentially building the totalitarian surveillance system China has, except this is just being implemented through businesses and corporations. In the United States is a big business and corporation, so it's no wonder that we see these kind of things implemented there. That's one of the things that we're looking at. We're looking at the nefarious underpinnings, the aspects of where this can go, because ultimately this has spiritual, you know, underpinnings. Me personally, I believe that Satan mimics everything that God does. His omniscience, okay, his omnipresence and his omnipotence, and he doesn't have that. We saw in the book of Job, you know, "Hey, well, what were you doing? I was going back, you know, back and forth throughout the earth," right? And the Bible tells us that he wanders back and forth. The devil wanders back and forth throughout the earth, like a lion seeking whom he can devour. So the devil doesn't have the omnipresence, the omniscience, and the omnipotence that God has. And I think that through basically channeling this information from the other side of the veil through mediums, and that's what, you know, our government is deeply steeped in this occult and this mysticism, all this other stuff. By channeling that information through mediums, they're able to develop these kind of technologies that is essentially giving Satan omnipresence. We see that our internet service providers can essentially track what we're doing online and sell our internet history. Our phones can monitor, you know, what apps we have on our screen. I mean, even iPhones, they have screen time. You can see how long you were using, you know, your navigation, how long you were using FaceTime, how long you've been text messaging. That is all that information is being sent to these businesses and corporations. But more nefariously, if we're talking about spiritual implications here and an entity on the other side of this network, we're talking about building a network that allows omnipresence, so we get to see what everybody's doing at the same time. You know, the omnipotence and the omniscience, that's coming. Knowing everything and being everywhere and being able to do anything, that's what we're talking about here. We're talking about some, I mean, this goes back, you know, all the way to the Tower of Babel. This is some pretty heavy stuff, and essentially this is what this whole channel kind of ties into. It goes to show you the way that the modern sort of innovations that we're having are nothing new is under the sun. We're going back to what we're trying to achieve, something that we had once before, and we're trying to go back to that, and all this stuff ties into that. But just looking into this stuff, just looking into the implications here, we're talking about these companies saying that they don't spy on people. That's a load. Okay, that's a crock. Because in the same breath, when we say, you know, one article, we don't spy on your doorbell cams, but another article, Amazon employs thousands of people, right, to listen to Amazon Alexa conversations. And in some instances, they say, oh, we might have even heard a sexual assault. So they can use this information as a way to be intrusive and tie this into law enforcement. We've already seen vestiges of that. All right. We have to be careful when it comes to this type of technology, because this technology is ultimately going to be used as a device against us. That's what it's about. Right now, it's painted as convenience, and we can't live without it, and we love it. And soon, the very same technology is going to be used to track us down. It's going to be used against us to see what our habits and behavior and you know, how we behave socially and stuff like that. Just like they have the social credit scoring system out there in China. All of this stuff is happening at the same time all across the pond. It's happening here in America. It's just repackaged in the different nations, the different states, and the different parts of the world, so it doesn't look the same. But for those who have the eyes to see and the ears to hear, it's pretty obvious what's coming here. It's pretty obvious that the totalitarian tiptoe is on track, that the New World Order is right on track, and the trajectory that we are currently on is going to be one that's ultimately not going to benefit the people. I mean, if we can't see that, we're more short-sighted than we realize. And I also understand not all of us have the eyes to see and the ears to hear. But those of us who do understand these implications, they understand where we're going. All right, and we're going to get into this stuff. We always get into this stuff. The way that I highlight stuff in this video so that the common person can sort of understand some of these threads without having to connect the dots for them, and then, you know, them getting lost by the wayside. I'd rather say, you know, 5 intelligible words than 100 in a tongue. And that's what I'm trying to do here. I'm trying to expand my audience, or at least encompass an audience that, one, the ones that do know what's going on, and two, the ones that don't, so we can try to include those, and we can try to bring those folks into the fold. Because I often say there's no reason to be sitting on top of this information if you can't convey it or articulate it to another individual in a way that makes a positive impact, or at least an impact where you could say, well, I've given you the information, you can bring a horse to water, but you can't force it to drink. And that's essentially what we're talking about here. There's no reason in sitting on top of the horde of water if you're not in some way giving it to some people to drink. There's some people who are going to take it. There's some people who aren't. It's just our job to put it out there. And with that, I think I'll leave it there. California Carter, signing off.